Okay, we're ready for the notes on Unit 2, Intro to Chem, and we're on Part 3. So this is the third section of your notes that you're filling in. And we're covering the science teaks, or chemistry teaks, 2F and G. C2F, I will collect data and make measurements with accuracy and precision. And C2G, I will express and manipulate chemical quantities using dimensional analysis, scientific notation, and significant figures. All right, look for Roman numeral number 4 on your notes. And first and foremost, remember that you're not in a math class. In a math class, you're learning technique or the procedure. How do you manipulate the numbers? And they are just numbers. You know, they're going to throw any number they want out there, and you're going to try and figure out, you know, how do we use this? How do we do this? How do we do that with these things? In chemistry class, those numbers that we're using actually mean something. They are some type of measurement, and because of that, they're not just bare naked numbers. They have to have a unit of measurement. So every single time you write the number down, any number, you should have a unit of measurement. Is it a gram? Is it kilograms? Is it Fahrenheit? Is it Celsius? Is it centimeters? So you don't just write a number down. You have to put the unit of measurement with it. All right, there are two major types of measurements that we deal with. One is quantitative and one is qualitative. Quantitative means it's a measurement that has a number. So we can describe something and say, for example, it's 105 degrees Fahrenheit outside. That's a quantitative measurement. Or we could just say, oh my gosh, it's really, really hot outside. That's qualitative. You know, and just depends on what we're doing, whether we need quantitative, qualitative, or in many cases, both. So depending on that situation, in most cases in your labs, we'll use both. We use quantitative. I mean, numbers are really, really important because numbers you can't deny. You say, oh, there are three of these things, you can actually obviously see, oh my gosh, sure enough, there are three of them. Whereas if you're saying things like, oh, well, it's a pretty blue. Well, first of all, pretty is opinion. So blue, you can generally say that, oh, yes, that's a qualitative measurement. So we need, in many cases, both. You might not. You might have something where you have to decide how many grams of a precipitate are produced, and then you also, while the reaction is going on, you might also say, "Oh, well, there were lots and lots of bubbles produced." You know, you're not going to have to count bubbles. There were 573 bubbles produced. That's not going to happen. But to say that there were bubbles produced is a really good observation, and it's a qualitative observation that you would write down. All right. In chemistry, we deal a lot with really, really big numbers and really, really small numbers. And instead of spending half your life writing these numbers out, what you can do is use scientific notation. So you've done this in a math class before. You've done the scientific notation in math class. You've worked with these types of numbers before. Now you're actually using it. Rather than just learning how to use it, you're actively using it. You're applying what you've learned before. So when we use scientific notation, we use exponents to shorten really large or really small numbers. So, for example, we've got one with 9 zeros after it. So instead of spending quite a while writing 9 zeros and making sure we've got all 9, we can move the decimal place left, get rid of a lot of those zeros, and say, oh, look, now we have 1 times 10 to the 9th. We moved the decimal place left 9 spots. If you have a really small number like 0.000004, again, instead of writing all 6 of those zeros, we can move the decimal to the right, and we can say 4 times 10 to the negative 7. Negative sign means you move the decimal to the right. 7, how many spots did you move that decimal? So letter A, the decimals move to shorten the number without changing the value. It's just a different way of writing the exact same number. Letter B, the exponent becomes the number of times the decimal slides. How many spots did you move the decimal? That's the little exponent up there, the superscript. Letter C, if the decimal slides to the left, the exponent will be positive. So remember, if it's a large number, you move it left. Large left. Large left. And letter D, if the decimal slides to the right, the exponent will be negative. Got it? Letter C, significant figures or sig figs. These are digits in the number that actually mean something. And it goes back to the fact that our numbers are actually measurements. And you can't get carried away with, you know, 7 or 8 digits to the right of the decimal, when, say, the ruler that you're using, you can only do 2 digits to the right of the decimal with it. You are limited to how many digits, you can carry it out to the right of the decimal by the tool that you're using. So the tool you use limits how precise your number is. You can't be more precise than your measurement tool. Your calculator, when you manipulate numbers in the calculator, it may give you 8 digits to the right of the decimal, but those are pretty much meaningless. So when we say, when we write those numbers down for our answers, we can only write the ones that mean something, the ones that are significant. The best tool that we have in our chemistry class are the best tools we have are the digital scales, and they can measure to 3 digits to the right of the decimal. That's the maximum. That's the best we could ever do in this classroom. In most cases, you're going to have either 3, 2, or 1 digit to the right of the decimal maximum. Now, that doesn't talk about all of the sig figs. I'm just kind of focused right now on how many digits to the right of the decimal you have. But don't get carried away with putting all the digits that your calculator gives you as your answer. There are some rules. How do you tell how many numbers to write down for your answer? Okay, rule number one, if it's not a zero, it's a significant number. So that's the first thing. Not a zero, significant number. Number two, sandwich zeros are significant. Sandwich zeros is like a sandwich. You've got the bread on either side and the zeros in the middle. So you've got the significant numbers, the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 on either end, and the zeros in the middle. So those are significant. They count. Number three, trailing zeros are only significant if there's a decimal point. So 1, 2, 3, 0, 0, since there's a decimal point, those two zeros trailing off the end are significant. So that number has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 significant figures. And number four, leading zeros, like 0.012, leading zeros are never significant. Decimal, no decimal, it doesn't matter. If they're in front of the number, when we count up how many sig figs they have, we don't count those. The key is you still have to write it down, but they don't count as significant figures. Significant figures are kind of a weird concept to wrap your brain around, and we'll do some practice with these sig figs. Number five, the last one is the best one. The last one says if you get an exact number off of a chart, it's a constant, or it's a table, something got off of a table, then we don't care how many sig figs it has. You can have a lot, you can have a little, it just doesn't matter, we don't have to worry about those. So the numbers that are on the periodic table, hallelujah, we don't have to count sig figs on those, and we'll use those numbers a lot. Oh my gosh, it's the end! And look, the bell's ringing!